If you're in the market for a 40 to 45 foot flybridge, there are plenty of options. The Greenline 45, Prestige 420, the Sealine F430, Bavaria R40, the Princess F45. But none of them can do this.
The balconies are a cost option, but the UK dealer now includes them as standard, such is their popularity. Talking of costs, this particular 400 had a huge spec on it, costing £710,000, but a more restrained UK spec boat with twin D6 440s would cost in the region of £560,000. Now then, let's have a closer look at this pocket transformer.
Where else do you start but back here in this spectacular cockpit? We'll start right here on the transom. You have a high-low bathing platform here as an option. Nice addition is that you have steps built in, so as the platform goes down, that becomes a nice run of steps to help you get between the cockpit and the platform itself. Back here, you lift up. It's more than a wet bar, really. It's a proper galley back here. You've got chopping board, grill, obviously, your sink, and then you have a top-loading fridge here as well, or cooler. It's quite useful, it's got a drain in it as well, so it'll drain off. And then we really see the effect of these amazing balconies. They fold down really pretty quickly at the touch of a button, then you have to put in these bars. I imagine a lot of people just leave those off and you can jump off and use it for snorkeling and swimming and things. But they just make such a great effect back here. And it's almost, the smaller the boat, because Galeon obviously do this and a lot of their models, the smaller the boat, the greater the effect. We come over this way, that they've set up a table and chairs. It's really nice and it genuinely gives you extra usable space that you simply wouldn't have. And when they fold up in line with the side deck, so you still have a nice amount of room to walk up forward to the foredeck. Some more clever stuff in this cockpit as well. The table folds out into an L shape, so that folds like that. This one folds like this. And then this is a two-way seat. So if we just move this cushion, this folds back that way like that, so that two people can sit facing out and they have some access to the table. But this chair has another neat trick, because it will actually come all the way round. So if I pull this back, this edge comes around to here, so it nearly meets the seating here. There's still enough space to walk through if you want to, but then you have this seat sort of across the threshold, inside, outside, another nice addition, so more people can sit here in the cockpit. And there's some clever stuff here as well. So this section here flips down to make a little perch. Putting flippers on, something like that, gives you somewhere to sit. And then this area here, lift up this cushion, and I'll do this. Gives you little raised backrest. The table then folds down. You have an infill cushion here, so you can make a sun pad up here as well if you want.
Despite the show-stealing cockpit, we mustn't forget that there's a really good flybridge to enjoy aboard the 400 as well. Seating is comfortable, arranged around a substantial teak table. There's a twin helm station and a wet bar, and though there's no hardtop option, there is a bimini that folds away in front of the helm station when not in use.
The doors slide right across to the port side to really open up the saloon to the cockpit. Of course, they'll also slide over this way. They close this area off and you just have the opening door on the port hand side. But this makes it feel very open, and there's a real good connection between the cockpit and the saloon. Now, this being a galleon, there's a huge amount of choice when it comes to the finish on the inside of the boat. This one's got the high gloss mahogany wood, ivory leather, and you have this nice sort of marble effect Corian, which looks really smart. It's quite a classic finish, but it's executed really nicely, and there's loads of light in here from these floor to ceiling windows that seem to sort of disappear down behind the furniture. You get lots of natural light in here, and as I said, the finish is to a really high standard. Lovely woodwork. Now, the galley here is forward on the main deck. You have a twin induction hob, you have an isotherm fridge down here under the counter. Again, the finish is really good, really nice tap here, and the way this comes out, the sink cover, and it slots in there, It's always hard to store those things. They can be quite annoying to store. So it's good that it's got a dedicated slot, and it also works as a bit of a splashback. So when you're washing up, you're not going to get water everywhere. Another standout feature of this part of the boat is this enormous side door. I mean, there are side doors and then there are side doors, and this one is just gigantic. You can lock it in various places, but with it right open, it really, really opens this area up, and you get lovely natural breeze coming in through here. And because you've got an opening electric window on the port side as well, you do get a nice through breeze. And it just feels very open and very bright, especially because the windscreen is so big, and as I said, it's single piece as well. So sitting here at the lower helm, it's really bright, you've got excellent communication, you can get out easily to help out and crew. It's a nice helm as well, it's stylish, it's ergonomically very smart. I like the fact that you've got full digital twin MFDs in front of you. We've also got your analog dials for quick references, and of course a nice simple bank of rocker switches here for the controls that you're going to use very often. It's even nice to see a proper rudder indicator on a twin shaft drive boat like this. It's nice to know where the rudders are pointing before you begin slow speed manoeuvres. The weather's come in, we can see the saloon in more of a cosy mode. Pop the TV up, that's done by a control, pops up from behind the sofa here. But the point is, it's raining, but you still get a lot of light in here. If you were stuck in here on a rainy day, having to stick a film on or play a board game, you've still got great views, you're still at a good level, and you've still got lots of glass. So yes, the weather's a bit miserable, but it's still a nice place to sit and while away the hours. We head down to the lower deck with this run of steps here from the main deck. You notice this really nice substantial banister here, well located to help you up and down the stairs. And if we turn back on ourselves, this is what Galeon would describe as the master cabin. However, it's a little bit compromised. If I stand here in the doorway, I can stand absolutely fine. But once you enter the cabin proper, you are stooped over, kneeling, crouching. You know, it's something that you don't have on some of this boat's rivals, like the Prestige 420, for example. However, that is just something you have to factor into this boat. So you have got this compromised headroom here in this midships cabin. However, it is still finished to a really high standard. The wood works lovely. You've got a flat screen television down here. I love the detailing, the bendy reading lights on either side. You've got this nice backlit bedhead here as well, and sockets both sides so people can charge their phones. You have individual heating controls for this cabin as well. And this nice little vanity area here as well. Pop-out stool, bit of storage, and a bureau here with a mirror. And then you have a hanging locker here. It actually auto-illuminates. If there's no cushions in there, of course. I like the strip lighting as well. That's quite nice. And actually, when you get to the ensuite, headroom improves massively. So you can come inside here and stand up straight, even if you're 6 foot or over. Headroom's good in here. And note how you've got rain shower heads, which is quite a nice touch. And again, all of this, these fittings are really classy and of a high standard. You have Tecmar toilets, and back under behind the door is where you find the sink. And if I were the owner of this boat, even though this is supposedly the master cabin, I think I'd be using this forward cabin, nominally the VIP. For using regularly, I think this is the better space because you've got the headroom in here. It's really easy to stand up. You've got good storage in here. You've got hanging wardrobes on both sides, storage dotted all the way around both sides, sockets here either side of the bed, and you've got repeaters for lights, so you can control all the cabin lighting from the bed, so you don't have to get out of bed to use them. And again, you have control for the heating in here as well, and really nice lighting. Again, I keep talking about the lighting, but they do it really well. You've got subtle backlighting here, you've got the strip lighting, so you can set the mood in here. Doesn't have to be as bright as it is now. You've got nice big windows. You know, they're nearly the same size as the ones in the master cabin, so you do get good amounts of natural light in here, and you've got an opening port, and you've got these big skylights overhead as well. You haven't got the cushions on the foredeck, and you do get a nice dollop of natural light coming in through these. And of course, this opens for ventilation or is an escape hatch. As standard, you get split berth, so you just remove this center section, and then this berth slides this way, this berth slides this way, and within a matter of seconds, you've got a double. So if you've got a couple staying in here, they can share the same bed. If it's two people, you can have two singles like this. So it does make it a bit more versatile, and you've got a bit of storage underneath each one as well. And this cabin is en suite to the day heads, and that's a really good size. Actually, if I just close this door, we'll go back out. This is the day heads access, so you can get to it in the day without having to go into the cabin. And there you can see, you know, it's well specced. It's just as nicely finished. Bit of storage under the sink here, and again, a good shower cubicle and another rain shower head. Now this boat is available with twin stern drives, IPS or shaft drives. This particular boat has got shaft drives, actually V drives, and it's got the largest pair of Volvo Penta D6 440 horsepower engines for a top speed of day of just over 30 knots. And the most comfortable cruising speed is between 22 and 25 knots. There it's got a nice running attitude, though you do want a bit of trim tab. It's quite heavy, this boat, certainly the stern, if you've got the hydraulic bathing platform. Obviously you've got the folding balconies, and you may add a tender or jet ski to that. So it does like a bit of trim tab. About half tab does just keep the bow down a bit, and means your view forward is good. And it also means that the sharpest part of the hull is cutting through the water. But it gets up and goes nice and quickly, and as I said, tops out comfortably at over 30 knots. Now there are some fly bridges of this size where you would really avoid having to drive downstairs. You'd only do if you really had to, whereas on this boat it's actually a real pleasure to drive the boat from the lower helm because it's so bright. You have this huge one-piece windscreen, and then you have this massive side door which in good conditions you can open and give you nice ventilation. It just feels really bright and airy, and you have a fantastic all-round view as well. Single-piece windscreen means you do have thicker mullions, but they have at least put in some quarter windows here so you can see things that are coming from the starboard side. And of course you have the side door too, so you can pop your head out of there and have a look around. There's very few obstructions behind you too, so you've got a nice all-round view from down here. I really like the ergonomics of the lower helm as well. It's got a twin bench, but it slides so I can get myself nice and close to the helm. And the presentation's great. You've got a mix of the twin MFDs, but you have analog dials as well. So for a quick glance at revs, temperatures, they're there right in your eye line. You don't have to be flicking through menus. But of course, you can calibrate these two screens to display whatever you want. So you have some flexibility there. Everything falls to hand really easily. The wheel's in a good position. It's nice and close to the throttles. It's a bit short on storage space. You've got one cup holder, so where you'd put loose items like mobile phones, a handheld VHF, I don't really know, they could improve that. But really the helmsman's lot is pretty good. For me, I think this is the drivetrain and engine options to go for. The largest engines on shaft drives, I just think that you're not gonna lose out much in terms of performance. Okay, maneuverability, if you're more comfortable with the joystick, then IPS is the one. But this is still a nice boat to drive, and there's not much penalty when it comes to performance. And also it's going to be easy to maintain. You haven't got to service the pods, you've just got a pair of shafts to look after. But I do think you want the highest horsepower, because if you've got a heavily optioned boat like this one with the hydraulic platform, the platforms, you chuck a tender on, cruising gear, I feel like the smaller engines may be struggling mid-season when you've got, you know, a full cruising load and maybe a bit of growth on the hull to really shift the boat's weight, especially in a bigger sea. So for me, I think it pays to, the extra outlay for the larger engine is probably worth it if you can stretch to it. For a boat that is quite wide and quite heavy, the hull actually cuts through the water really nicely. The ride is solid, it's gentle, it's forgiving, it doesn't slam, it doesn't judder, there's no squeaking or rattling coming from this interior. It feels very solid. It feels like it would be comfortable if it really did kick up. We haven't had it in huge seas today, but we've been through a fair amount of wash, and there was a chop out in the Solent, and dealt with everything really well. I was impressed with how comfortable it felt. Ordinarily, on an old school flybridge boat, you'd never berth it from the lower helm, but because you've got this side door here, you've got a good connection to your crew, you've got a great view, it's not really a problem. And actually, when you're berthing starboard too on this boat, this is where I'd rather be.
When considering the 400, it comes down to a simple question. Does its best-in-class main deck compensate for the lack of standing headroom in the amidships cabin? If you prize cabin comfort over everything, then there are better options. But if you cherish deck space and enjoy life at anchor, nothing in the sector can touch the Galeon. Thank you very much for watching our review of the Galeon 400. Please hit the like button if you enjoyed it, and hit subscribe so you never miss one of our uploads.